Okay, good morning, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to this, the 30th meeting in 2015 of the Economy, Energy and Tourism Committee. Can I welcome all members, welcome our witnesses, who I'll come to in a second, and welcome any visitors in the gallery, and can I remind everyone please to turn off, or at least turn to silent, all mobile phones and other electronic devices so they don't interfere with the sound equipment. Item one on the agenda, can I ask if members are content that we take item four, a review of evidence in private? That's great. Thank you very much. Item two on the agenda, we have before us a piece of subordinate legislation, the Diligence Against Earnings Variation Scotland Regulations 2015, that's SSI 2015/370. That copy of that has been circulated to members. Members have any issues they wish to raise in relation to this instrument? No. In that case, are members content that the instrument comes into force? Okay, that is agreed. Thank you. Item three on the agenda, we are starting a short inquiry into the future prospects for oil and gas in Scotland. And I'd like to welcome this morning our first panel of witnesses. We are joined today by Tommy Campbell, who's industrial organiser for Unite the Union, Stephen Boyd, Assistant Secretary of the Scottish Trade Unions Congress, and Jake Molloy, who's regional organiser of the RMT. So welcome to you all and thank you for coming along. I think what we'd like to do in the time available is explore some of the issues that are covered in your written submissions that we've received around the prospects for the oil and gas sector, its wider impact also on the Scottish economy and particularly the impact on the workforce. So we're going to run this till about 11:15. What I would ask members to do is keep their questions as short and to the point as possible, and answers as short and to the point as possible would be helpful to get through the topics we want to cover in the time available. And because we don't necessarily want all three of you answering every single question, what I would ask if members could perhaps direct their questions initially at one member of the panel, and then if other members of the panel want to come in and respond, just catch my eye and I'll bring you in as best I can as time allows. I wonder if I could just start off and ask all of you, just in a couple of minutes, if you could just summarise for us what, in your view, are the key issues currently facing the sector, and perhaps more particularly looking at the role of government, looking at the role of industry, looking at the role of oil and gas authority, what would be your key asks, maybe no more than one or two, that needs to be done in a policy sense to try and make the situation better? I'll maybe just start with Mr. Campbell and work my way across the panel.
Well, we certainly want to make sure that any approach to any of the problems is done in a tripartite way, that it's done by all the employers along with all the trade unions, but also involving the politicians and the government. But mixed into those ingredients has to be the workforce. They're the ones that are critical to this. We should never forget the fact that when we talk about the oil and gas industry, we're talking about workers and their families. And of course, it's them that's suffering the most now as a consequence of this crisis. It has to be said that the employers that are crying out because of the crisis aren't suffering financially. They're just not making as much profit as they used to. But the workers are the ones that have got less income. And we're seeing the detrimental effect. We've got figures, as has been mentioned, which is a guesstimate of about 65,000 jobs. If we look at it, that's the equivalent to about 20 car factories, 20 shipyards. You know, it would be being treated as a national crisis if that was the case. Approximately about 6,000 jobs on the platforms and rigs themselves, we reckon, have gone. About 30,000 in the support companies that are backing up the industry. And then rippling out from that, of course, approximately another 30,000 jobs in the hotel, catering. And anecdotally, I can tell you, I met with taxi drivers in Aberdeen last week, and they were indicating to me that their takings are down this year, approximately an average of over 20%. They're seeing it themselves with the squeeze from the type of trade they would get from the oil companies. So it's not just the oil and gas, and it's not just offshore. It's now coming onshore as well. So there are initiatives. I know that given that I'm based in Aberdeen, we have to, you know, thank the local authority there, all the parties there and the independent politicians there working together. in terms of the city deal, that they're looking at both the crisis as it's happening and as actually trying to project in the long term. And that's, of course, something we would welcome, that there has to be a planned approach, a plan to this economic crisis. We're talking about people losing their jobs, and that's skills that are coming out of the industry as well. But the direction of traffic coming this way, we have to forget we've got young people, young men and women, who should be seeing that there's a future in that industry, who are developing their skills, going to university, developing their skills and apprenticeships. And what would they be thinking now? Give you another anecdotal example, the change to the rotas, this tree and tree, which we'll deal with later as well. A figure that's banded about is that the savings in the helicopter costs alone is approximately £150 million. So that comes out of the system. And the rippling effect of that is that there's over 20 young apprentices in one company, helicopter company alone. Helicopter engineer apprentices are now going to lose their jobs, along with other people losing their jobs. So there is a crisis. So we do want to work together. I'm sure my colleagues will come in. We're starting to see an inward trend of cowboy operators. We've got concerns about that. And of course, our primary concern about that is that their attitude towards safety would be leaving a lot to be desired. So I'll leave it with my colleagues to add a few comments as well.
Okay, thank you. Stephen Boyce.
If I could maybe just turn to the kind of economy-wide issues, from the SWC's perspective, I think are extremely important. And I think, the reason we welcome the committee taking an interest in the sector is what has happened over the last year. I think has been a massive scale and is perhaps still underappreciated out there. I don't think people really get the impact that the falling oil prices had in the sector. And you ask about the issues facing the sector. Well, it's a statement of the obvious, but when that price collapses, a massive issue. But underneath that, it looks as if the economics of the industry have fundamentally changed, and with that, the offshore sector in Scotland, which is relatively expensive way of extracting oil, is facing pressures, of an order of magnitude more than other oil producing nations around the world who are able to, improve their productivity at a much faster rate. And I think we're already seeing the impact of that in Scotland in terms of economic and labour market performance through the middle part and latter part of this year, Scotland relative to the rest of the UK. What's happening in the industry is undoubtedly having a wider impact. So in terms of what's got to change, I think it's very difficult to do that within 2 minutes. I think you're looking across a huge range of issues for all the different industry actors. But I think, again, you have to realise that it's a high cost jurisdiction, and I think the industry as a whole has been atomised. It hasn't, as the Budge Review recognised, it hasn't collaborated well, when you compare to the way the industry is run in the UK continental shelf and the way it's run in other North Sea jurisdictions. It's very different and the cost bases are very different. Something has to be done about that. The industry hasn't innovated in the way it should. It hasn't collaborated. But I think there are opportunities there as well. Moving forward, decommissioning would be the obvious one. It provides a route to diversification, it provides a route to saving jobs, it provides an opportunity for Scotland to develop expertise that can then be exported around the world. So I think in terms of, the way Tommy's described, the response has to be, I don't really like using the word partnership because it can be loaded, but, it has to involve all the industry partners working very closely together. I think we have seen, as Tommy again says, through some of the industry groups that are listed in our submission, we've seen some quite good activity. I think the Energy Jobs Task Force has started to drive some of that collaborative activity that hitherto, wasn't apparent. So I think we are making progress, but I think there's an awful lot to be done. And again, Tommy and Jake are far better placed, I think, to describe some of the really worrying stuff that's happening at workplace level that I think we all have to be cognizant of.
Jake Molloy.
There are so many issues, as Stephen said, it'd be difficult to cover them all in 2 minutes, but it's the consequence of the industry approach, this slash and burn approach. There seems to be little take up or engagement on how we can be more efficient, more productive without the blunt instrument of redundancy and cutting terms and conditions. That, I believe, is having, and we're just in its infancy now, is having the effect of developing this culture of fear someone I've been personally involved with after the big slump in 86, and we all know what happened in 88. It's a different environment now. We've got a different regulator, different machinery, different mechanisms, but there's clearly a culture of fear developing on the ground where workers are reluctant to challenge, reluctant to question, reluctant to report, for fear of losing their jobs. Now, that doesn't necessarily make it unsafe, but it does absolutely make it less safe. And that's a serious worry. But not only that, that culture has other knock-on effects in terms of the lack of maintenance being done, the backlog of maintenance, how we maintain the infrastructure to develop and exploit what's left. And if we're not careful, because of a lack of investment, a lack of maintenance, we could very rapidly lose a lot of the infrastructure, and it becomes uneconomical, and so we start leaving the oil in the ground. The other big fear from the maritime side of things is the drive to reduce cost, which is seeing many of our traditional UK supply companies virtually on the brink of closure. I've said it once already, and I'll say it again, a fear for the British seafarer in the oil and gas sector. I think we're looking probably Christmas time, New Year, there'll be little or no British seafarers left in the oil and gas sector. It's undoubtedly a race to the bottom. Day rates have been cut by such an extent. We're seeing the use of second registration vessels, flag of convenience vessels, exploitation of foreign nationals, social dumping, which I don't know fits with the Scottish government's drive for fair work conventions and a living wage. I mean, this isn't a living wage, it's not a minimum wage, it's way, way below that. The knock-on of all that, future skills gaps, the social dumping continues, and as Stephen's alluded to, the potential then is because they've created this low-cost environment, they will not, absolutely not, and I say they, the oil and oil companies, will not consider any opportunities which we as a society would look to in terms of decommissioning. I mean, we've got steel plants closing down when we've got huge steel platforms that need recycling. We've got debate about diversity in the Clyde. We've got huge platforms that can be taken in there in the deep water and decommissioned and used. We can maintain some form of manufacturing in this country by using the means which we have through licensing, through the OGA, to ensure that if they're going to exploit our natural resources, there should be some return for us as a society. And I see that as being diminished to the point that it's going to be a seriously lost opportunity. I don't see it turning around until somebody's hurt. That's a real, real worry. How you, as a government, can change that, I think we really need all of the regulators, Oil and Gas Authority, Health and Safety Executive, even the CAA, to be in the room and setting down parameters which are considered to be operating standards for the UK sector. We have NORSOC standards in Norway which dictate how the oil companies operate there. We must take the oil companies into some kind of forum which sets standards rather than see this race to the bottom.
Okay, well, thank you for that summary, and you've all raised a huge range of issues which I think we want to explore in more detail in the time available. Just before I move on, a couple of follow-ups I want to ask myself. We did, as a committee, in Jeremy Corbyn style, ask the public if they had any questions they wanted to put, and we do have a question from Yvonne in Aberdeen, which I will just read to you, and she asks this: are the trade unions fighting the change, or are they working with businesses to ensure a sustainable future for oil and gas in Scotland? So who wants to respond to that? Tommy Campbell?
I'll answer that. Yeah. It's a very good question from Yvonne. Stephen mentioned the word partnership. and sometimes it can create a different thought process in people's minds. I believe in working in cooperation for the greater good of the people that we represent. That means we have to sit in the same room as the bosses. And that means, for example, some people on the outside might think that you're in bed with the employers, but the only time I get into bed with any bosses is to have a pillow fight. The point has to be made that we are currently in dispute on a number of fronts with businesses in the oil and gas industry. There's a current ballot taking place on the quota side, which involves ourselves and the RMT. And we're also currently trying to resolve a dispute on the OCA side as well. So we're working hard because we also recognise that the industry is in crisis. But as I said in my opening comments, we don't see the reason why the workforce should be the ones that should carry the greatest burden of that, and also those who are affected in the onshore environment as well. Because it's not just in Aberdeen. I mean, the reason why I made that point about the analogy about car factories and shipyards is that the workforce who work particularly in the north thing, but it's the whole UK continental shelf. It's right around the UK. So it's people working who come from England, Wales, Scotland, Ireland, and from other countries as well. And we don't want to see a race to the bottom, as Jake has quite rightly mentioned. We want to see, you know, common standards of good employment practices, good employment rights, good health and safety. We want to bring all the players into the same room. Because what we'll have is a situation where those at the top, the major oil companies who are still making significant profits, are keeping their distance and then saying to the contractors, basically, it's your shout how you handle this, but they're being really told, you will cut. And the only people they can cut from, of course, is the workforce, because they're going to protect their profits as well. So as Jake and Stephen says, we will need, and we do need, you know, sort of state intervention, both at Scottish and UK level, to bring this to a halt and say, look, this is becoming irresponsible now. We've got an industry here that's exploiting the natural resources of the United Kingdom, exploiting resources off the coast of Scotland, and the payback should be that they should have social responsibility and be using the profits that are generated by the people we represent to put back and invest in our communities, both for now and in the future as well.
Okay, just briefly, please.
Yeah, just one point. It's difficult to be in partnership with employers who can't negotiate with you. And that's the situation we find ourselves. We're talking to employers for whom our members work with, but they're being dictated to by a third party, the oil companies. And when they're being dictated to, they will do what their clients dictate as opposed to what the workforce are looking for.
Okay, and one more question on a slightly different topic. I think, Stephen Boyd, you talked about diversification and looked at, you know, how do you use the skills acquired in the industry elsewhere in the economy. Is an opportunity to reuse skills in oil and gas acquired offshore on onshore technologies such as unconventional gas? And what is your view, therefore, of the moratorium on fracking that the Scottish Government currently has?
I think we always have to tread very carefully when we talk about diversification. I think it is a word people fling around without really thinking through the process from where we are now to where we want to get to. I think there are opportunities. We've spoken for a long time about the possible synergies between the skills in oil and gas and offshore renewables. Unfortunately, we haven't seen the progress in offshore renewables that would allow that flow of employees from one sector to the other. So, I mean, I think that remains a major challenge. In terms of the specifics round about fracking, I don't know the answer to that question. I'm not entirely sure about how closely aligned the skills in the offshore sector are with fracking. In terms of the moratorium, the SDUC essentially, we took a position at Congress last year that essentially supports the Scottish Government's moratorium for the time being. I think, like the Scottish Government, we will be constantly revisiting that over the next few years as the energy policy debate progresses and as the situation in the offshore oil and gas sector progresses as well. I think, you know, we have to look very closely at other opportunities for diversification. I think, you know, Scottish Enterprise have been playing a very important role in the North East at the moment, particularly through Lena's chairing of the Energy Jobs Task Force. But I think in terms of trying to drive that collaboration, I discussed in the past. But I think, you know, we would want Scottish Enterprise, and, you know, the Scottish Government needs to resource this activity if necessary. It has to be looking very, very closely at what are the real diversification opportunities here and what government investment is required to realise those opportunities.
Okay. 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 I'll bring in Dennis Robertson.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning. Perhaps if I could, well, first of all, I should declare an interest. I'm one of the co-conveners of the Oil and Gas UK cross-party group here in Holyrood. Maybe I'll direct my question to Jake Molloy first. Jake, you've painted a fairly bleak picture, and you've used terms like fear within the workforce, fear of losing their jobs if they were to report health and safety measures. Now, I think we're all too aware of 1988 and the impact that had, and obviously thereafter the health and safety initiatives. Are you suggesting that health and safety is being compromised offshore at the moment?
Right at this moment in time, it's difficult to quantify it because in actual fact, the statistics suggest that safety performance is slightly improved. But it was the same in 1986, albeit the statistics weren't as robust as they are today. I'm trying to preempt the inevitable, I think. And I think we've got anecdotal evidence. We're talking downstairs. You know, if you can't make a complaint about a lack of rest because the room you're sharing is occupied by a rather loud snorer without fear of being sacked, and that's what has happened, then are you likely to challenge on maintenance procedures? Are you likely to challenge on unsafe acts? It's the culture. Call it fear, call it reluctance to talk, call it perception of fear, call it what you will, but it's that reluctance to challenge which I've rounded up as this underlying entity of fear, which detracts from the ability to stop the job and challenge. That's what I'm trying to explain.
Yeah, you'll be aware that industry themselves, the companies, say that safety is paramount. It's above anything else and everything else. Are you questioning their suggestion in terms of that safety is paramount? That this fear culture is there because of redundancies, that some measures may not, or some incidents may not be getting reported, so therefore the industry is not aware?
I'm not questioning people at the senior level. I'm not doubting their commitment to making things safe. But take that to the very bottom level. Just in the last week, a group of workers working for a major contractor are told, you're redundant as of the 18th of November. And the company that's taking you over is this company, Company X, and you need to contact them. No transfer of undertakings, no redundancy, no consultation. We've gone, they're running the job. The guys have to apply for their own jobs, but have to apply with a £5 million employer's liability insurance certificate and work as self-employed workers. I cannot, for the life of me, see a self-employed worker who's working on a day rate basis, reliant on producing the goods, standing up and challenging his main client. I just don't see it happening. I don't speak from experience. I've never been self-employed. But is that the culture that we really want? A culture of self-employed, sham, zero-hour type contracts in place in a safety-critical, major accident hazard environment? I'm not convinced that's conducive to good safety practice.
Before maybe any of the other witnesses maybe want to come in, you also suggested that the seafaring, in terms of British employees within the seafaring, is being compromised. Flags of convenience, that sort of thing. Do you believe that obviously the health and safety then of the seafarers and the work that they associate with the offshore is being compromised because there's a different health and safety initiative or level within people coming in that you're suggesting?
There's no doubt about it. I've done International Transport Federation inspections on some vessels of flag of convenience, and the Filipino workers, Indonesian workers look upon you as the police arriving to save them. from purgatory. It's some of the conditions are appalling on some of these ships. And what worries me most about that is that industry has invested millions in developing competence to a standard which delivers safe operations. And we're seeing that dumped and replaced by less competent, less able, less willing workers who are being exploited to exploit our natural resources. Again, I'm not convinced.
Safety must be compromised.
Absolutely. There's no question about it. Yeah.
Okay. I wonder if any other witnesses...
Tommy. Yeah. As always is the case, a very difficult area to produce proof. But let's look at another industry, the construction industry, where the unions got lucky and the workers got lucky and were able to uncover the scandal of the consultant association in collaboration with major construction players. And you're well aware of the history of this now, and it's still ongoing in the courts. And I think it's a safe bet to say that that level of behaviour, which was widespread within that industry, it's safe to say that it's very typical in other industries as well, but we're not able to get the proof of it. What we do have is, when we have a situation, and my colleague Jake and other trade union officials dealing with the offshore, when we are talking with workers, both up at the heliports and when we're in communication with them over the phone and that, and they tell us things, they say, you know, you didn't hear this from me, and they're telling us things. And then we look at some of the evidence. There's been inspections by the authorities. It shows that in a number of installations last year, that the safety critical element was quite high. They were scoring the highest points where there was a question mark over the integrity of the installation. That should give you some indication that something isn't right. And it's sad that what happens is it's when there's a major incident that in hindsight, when there's the inquiries and everything else, that people then start to say, well, you know, I could have said so then, but I was afraid to speak out. So it's what there is in terms of an absence. We raised this very factor at a meeting yesterday with the OCA employers, that we were wanting them to promote more strongly the idea that workplace representatives, union representatives, should be elected, and that idea should be promoted and encouraged within the companies. Because the real heroes, as far as I'm concerned, are the workers, the men and women, who do have the courage to speak up and speak out. But the history shows us that those people, somewhere along the line, get their cards marked. And when it comes to redundancies, they find themselves in that queue to go. And their suspicion, but again, we haven't got the hard evidence, is that somewhere along the line, they're getting NRB'd because they were seen to be speaking out about something that was detrimental to the company's interests. But that will never be written down. That's why we got lucky with the construction industry, with the consultant association, with those files being found. Maybe one day we'll have a WikiLeaks type situation in the oil and gas industry, and the lid could get opened up and we then find out that the truth that we kind of generally knew is definitely a truth. So we need to see the companies and the industry clearly coming up maybe with a charter to encourage people to definitely speak up and speak out, and that should be protected. But let's look at another example. Why is the industry so dead against a public inquiry into the helicopter disasters? When the committee of the UK government and parliament decided that there was a need for such an inquiry, an independent one in the summer of last year, it was a no-no on the basis of, it's not that bad, we're just as good as the Norwegian sector. In the 21st century, 38 people have lost their lives in our territorial waters as a result of helicopter tragedies. There hasn't been any deaths in Norway. So where's the comparison? The only comparison is that it's really quite bad here, so there's a need for that. So who blocked that? Who was behind that? Ask yourself that question, and when you look at the answer, then you have to say, is there a nervousness there? So on the one hand, the textbooks say they will have everything written down about their policies, which are health and safety, and we welcome these policies. But it's then the practical application all the way down the chain of command as to what happens when somebody really does put their hand up and points the finger and speaks up and speaks out. And they come through their unions then sometimes to do that because they want that anonymity. So like Jake, I do have serious concerns that something seriously could happen. And we don't want it to happen, of course, I have to emphasise that.
Is there a different application of health and safety or is it a one single standard that's being operated within the different offshore platforms, etc.? Is each company liable for their own safety, or is there a collaborative working together in order that there's a single standard? And if that's not the case, do you believe it should be?
I sat on a panel yesterday morning with Trevor Garlick, Chief Executive of BP, and this was the subject, simplification, standardisation. We need some proactive, positive input, and the workforce have been screaming out for it for years, because it's very difficult as an itinerant worker moving around the North Sea to go from Shell, who have a golden rules reporting system, risk assessment process, to BP, that have a completely different golden rules observation system and risk assessment process, to Apache and so on. That doesn't make for economic or efficiency or productivity improvements. There's an easy win there for the industry to change that and send a clear message to workers that this isn't just about cutting jobs and cutting your terms and conditions. We are introducing efficiencies across the board, but there's a reluctance to do it. They're talking about a six-month lead-in time with a pilot exercise.
Can you explain to us what this easy win is?
The easy win is that you have a common induction, a common permit of work, a common risk assessment. Instead of investing, each operator investing millions, training people to their specific standards, we have a common standard. So you can move around operator to operator, contractor to contractor, and know what the rules are and how you're expected to behave and how you intervene in an unsafe act.
Efficient and safe.
I think the figures produced in this very room last week were in the region of £200 million.
Thank you. Thanks.
Yes, Stephen.
Just quickly in relation to Mr. Robertson's first question, I lack Jake and Tommy's decades of experience in the sector. I've only very recently became involved, but over the last few weeks I've had the opportunity with Jake and us to meet a number of very senior players in the sector. Now, I don't doubt any of their good faith when it comes to supporting a decent health and safety regime, an excellent health and safety regime in the North Sea. But the problem is, when you enter a phase of rapid cost cutting, it can introduce bad incentives along the chain of employment, particularly at the lower and middle management side and for the employee side as well. So the incentive that should be there for employees to report every infraction of health and safety is no longer there, because there is a concern that this is going to tag them for future redundancy. So we have to realise that the law of unintended consequences is operating here, and it's not about questioning the bad faith of the people who are running the industry. It's just recognising what is happening and how we can best tackle it.
Sorry, convener, is there a system of anonymised reporting?
There's a health and safety hotline, but it's rarely, if ever, used, because it's because of the regulators' inability to announce unannounced visits. The lead-in time and the investigation time invariably identify the individual who's reporting. So what we have really is the hotlines on Tommy's desk and my desk, and we take it round that way.
Okay, I think Lewis McDonald's got some questions in the same area.
Thank you very much. Like Dennis, I'm a co-convener of the cross-party group on oil and gas, and we've had very good evidence there from trade unions over a period of time in terms of the industry. But one of the things that Stephen Boyd's paper highlights particularly is the high cost base of the UK continental shelf compared with other parts of the North Sea, and I think that was mentioned again this morning. I wonder if you could say why you think that is. I think there's been some mention of one or two aspects of that, but why that is the case and what can be done with your support to reduce that cost base that doesn't involve people losing their jobs or the terms and conditions of the offshore workforce being undermined?
At $130 a barrel, a lot of operators were reluctant to shut down and do maintenance. We've seen that play out in the 80s, we've seen it play out in the early 90s, and we're seeing it, regrettably, playing out to some extent now. And that's what worries me about the maintenance side of it. if workers were educated and trained and able, and at this minute in time they're not, but able to police maintenance backlog, safety critical maintenance, then you've got, to use an industry term, a win-win situation where the infrastructure has been maintained to the highest standard and it's usable going forward to exploit those resources that are left. But even now, and there was a speaker yesterday morning, Bob Egan, who works with HSE now, highlighted that only 70 safety reps of some 2,500 have gone through training, which will allow them to fulfil their roles to that extent, where they can actually go out and do competent inspections and competent assessments of maintenance standards. So, to answer your question, to reduce costs, you have proactive maintenance, so that when you have a breakdown, it's not a breakdown that lasts for a year or more, as has been the case in the past, and that's where we're heading again. We have infrastructure which is fit for purpose, has greater uptime, greater productivity, and with more maintenance, you actually reduce the level of activity on the installation and save costs there as well. I had this debate at the last Energy Jobs Task Force. We're seeing global corporations operate their business on a day-to-day basis. I'm not aware of any corporate body the size of some of the companies that we're talking about here work that way. You know, you normally have a year, 2 year, 3 year plans. Everything's been torn up right now. We're literally working on a day-by-day basis, and they don't know what they're doing the next day. That cannot be conducive to improving efficiency, reducing cost, and improving productivity.
I think the first thing to say is I don't think it's a question that can be answered with any great degree of certainty, because I'm not aware of any rigorous analysis being published which looks at the relative cost bases and the reasons behind them. So I mean, we're left to kind of speculate. So I think it's important to stress areas that don't cause the higher cost base, and I don't think you can attribute higher UKCS cost to relative to Norwegian cost down to wages, because I think wages in the Norwegian sector at least is high, same in the Danish sector as well. I don't think it's down to tax either. We can maybe come back to fiscal issues later if you want. I think in the past some might have attributed at least part of that explanation to regulation, but I think post-mid review we now have the regulator the industry wants, and I think that has been removed as perhaps an explanation. I think probably the deeper reasons are round about the lack of collaboration that Wood described in his review. It's a highly atomised sector, the UKCS, compared to the other jurisdictions. I think the lack of innovation, and clearly that's, you know, if you're Statoil, there's no risk if you want to innovate in the Norwegian sector, because I mean, you hold the benefits of that innovation yourself. If you're a player in the UKCS, then there's a major risk of you taking that initial innovation, because the benefits of that you might not capture them. You know, it's an age-old problem about risk taking. I think it's round about innovation, collaboration, but I mean, I think this requires much deeper analysis that I'm not aware has been undertaken.
I'm just going to simply say that
if yous owned the industry, it was nationalised and the crisis was still the same, we'd be knocking your door and saying, instead of paying these highly skilled workers off, there's all this maintenance that needs to be done. In a smaller scale, it's like a transport company who's, you know, run into a bit of a bad patch. I come across that. I used to deal with the road haulage industry, and there'd be downtime for maybe a couple of weeks just, you know, and they'd have people cleaning up the yards and doing a bit of the odd jobs, a bit of maintenance work and all the rest of it. So in a micro sense and the macro sense, the same could be done. These people are, we're talking about transferring the skills to an offshore, to an onshore situation. This would be, they're in their own territory. They know this is their work, this is their own work environment. They simply are relocated to do other kinds of high maintenance work. Just because they turn the top off production doesn't mean that they should just disappear just like that. Mm-hmm. So that needs your intervention to be start pointing the finger about these skills should be kept there. And whilst we're waiting for the upturn to come, people could be getting on with their own maintenance programme. Getting them, and it's, as Jake says, in the short term, somebody's budget just won't allow for that. and they might know it should be happening, but somebody above them be saying there's no money in the kitty, that's it. But somebody needs to bring that pressure to bear to say, well, there is money in the kitty, because you have got, at the senior level, at the higher oil companies, you have got that money and you can release it to allow that to happen. Now, yesterday, I think it was Shell was fined £20,000 for the leak of the oil, one of the biggest leaks, in, as I understand it. You know, you ask BP if they were to reflect back about deep, you know, Sea Horizon, what happened there, how much that's cost them. So, you know, they need to think forward as well, instead of just looking at the immediate budget. So the money's there and it could be planned. Could be planned properly.
Before you come back in, I just want to observe, we are about halfway through our time. I've got a long list of members who want to ask questions, so we need to tighten up just a little bit, if we can, on questions and responses.
Thanks. A very brief follow-up, I guess, specifically to Stephen, in response to his answer. People in the industry say, and regulators say, they get it, that the period of cutthroat competition has to be behind them and collaboration has to happen. Is that your experience and that of the trade unions? Is there a culture shift or a recognition of the need for a shift in behaviour within the industry leadership?
I mean, Tommy and Jake might have a better perspective on that than myself, but I mean, I think there is an understanding that that culture shift has to happen, and I think it might be appropriate to say we're in the early days of that culture shift happening. And certainly when we've had meetings with senior players in the sector, they all absolutely recognise that this has to happen. But you know, again, having, you know, when it comes to driving that culture change right through what are massive multinational firms, and you know, that atomised contractor base that I was discussing, that is a major job. You know, I mean, it's not something that's going to happen overnight. But you know, the other side of that is it's not something that we can leave for the future either. I mean, we have to be working as hard as we can at this moment in time to drive the culture change. I think, you know, the people involved in the Energy Jobs Task Force tell me that that is beginning to make a difference, and people are speaking to each other in a way that they weren't doing in the past. And you're beginning to see some of that collaboration happening. But I mean, I think we're at the very early stages of the journey.
If I can move on to the other area I was keen to explore, which was the question of the wider impact on the economy. And there was a bit of, Tommy Campbell made a reference to that at the outset. Neither the Scottish Government nor the UK Government has thus far commissioned any assessment of that impact. I wonder what that impact looks like from a trade union perspective, both within the North East and across the Scottish economy.
Serious impact. Give you another anecdotal example, beer delivery in the city of Aberdeen. Guys are telling me that there's pubs now that they used to deliver to once a week. Now do it once a month. You walk around the city. I was here last night in Edinburgh. I was walking around, noticed how some of the places was busy. You don't get that in Aberdeen now. I went past, drove past a city centre restaurant on Monday evening at the back of 6 o'clock, stuck in the traffic, had a look over, and I seen two people in it. You know, that type of business is going to need more than two people in it. So, and I know from talking to people in the pub business, and even the hotel industry has announced recently that they've seen a downturn. And I'll give you an example of that. This time last year, when we were trying to book shop stewards into hotels for our training courses, the average cost was about £150 a week, a night during the week. Monday of this week, we got somebody in for two nights into a city centre hotel for £51 bed and breakfast. Like that, just gives you an example. Spoke to people from Aircastle at the meeting yesterday with the negotiations with OCA, and they were another major city centre hotel, and they were saying at the back of 8 o'clock they were the only people in the breakfast room, and they got a sense, didn't ask the hotel, but the sense the hotel was very empty. So that's just in that part of it alone. So there is this rippling effect in the smaller industries. I know from Indian restaurants that I frequent in Aberdeen, just speaking to the owners of them, and they anecdotally again were telling me that they've seen lots of faces of customers that haven't been back this year. And I was saying, well, it'll be men, women that go offshore, come in for something the night before, and they're now gone. And they said that the hospitality sessions that they have with companies maybe have a night out for their management team and workers, that's gone as well. So it is rippling itself all the way down. So this idea that because the price of the oil has come down, there is a knock-on effect and a plus maybe for people in the road transport industry or fuel and the consumer having less, but it's not showing the upturn. It's not showing the upturn on the other side.
I mean, would be fantastic if I could answer that question in a data-driven way, but I mean, every time I come at the committee, I'm worrying about the quality of Scottish economic statistics. But I mean, it's true that we simply don't have the regional growth or the regional labour market up-to-date data that would allow us to answer that question in a credible fashion. So all we really have is the anecdotal evidence that Tommy has described, and that is something from an SWC perspective we've heard right across the board. And, you know, as Tommy's already alluded to, we begin to see that seep into the rest of the Scottish economy as well. You know, where, yes, it is primarily a North East Scotland issue, but it's not just a North East Scotland issue. And worryingly, yeah, you know, a few, I think, of Scottish engineering have already said there's been knock on, you know, across the manufacturing sector. Worryingly for me, it's the Highland economy that's been doing relatively well over the last couple of decades, and particularly up to the north, you know, and the oil and gas supply chain does, you know, track right up to Caithness. And, you know, if they begin to lose that economic benefit, then that is a real concern, and perhaps we risk losing a lot of those, you know, pretty significant advances we've made over the last couple of decades in trying to equalise the Highland and the rest of Scotland economies.
Just very quickly, Lewis, it's the other flip side of it is the we're losing innovation as well, we're losing skills, we're losing, you know, we were market leaders and have been market leaders for decades now. Much of the innovation that's been introduced worldwide has come from the North Sea through our learnings. We're losing that, and the knock-on effect for that goes into universities, schools, the whole apprenticeship model. Everything could be affected if this continues in the way it is.
Okay, we'll need to move on. Gordon MacDonald.
Just getting back to the subject of costs, obviously one aspect of cost is productivity. And, you know, indications that we've seen is that the Norwegian sector has a higher extraction rate than the UK continental shelf. Is there any particular reason for why UK has a 40% extraction rate while the Norwegian sector has a 60% extraction rate?
I would say because of the infrastructure and the lack of investment in that infrastructure, that instead of moving forward when times are good and putting equipment which is able to extract greater amounts from existing reservoirs, the tendency here has been to sit tight while going good, whereas Norway seem... Certainly talking to my Norwegian colleagues, and there's a couple of them in Aberdeen waiting for me right now, they seem to be a perpetual motion of going forward with technology and improving and investing in the existing infrastructure. But, I mean, there are good examples as well. Look at Forties, they've just found new oil. Beryl's just found new oil. Smaller operators coming in are prepared to make that investment. But I think the deterrent for them is in the way things are operated with the existing infrastructure. I made this comment to Oil and Gas UK that for every barrel of oil that Apache produced in the 40s, they have to pay BP revenue to put it into their pipeline to get it ashore. Nobody does that in Norway. Nobody does it in Denmark. Nobody does it in Holland. So the big oil that own most of the infrastructure and take revenue from it is a deterrent to producing more oil as well, because there's a cost element to it. There needs to be a different approach there as well.
And just looking at that whole cost element, you know, do we know what the production break-even point is for? I know all the rigs are in different places and therefore they have different challenges, but do we know roughly what the break-even point for oil production is? I mean, the North Sea's been in production for 40 years, and for 30 of those years, the Brent crude price has been below $40 a barrel, and it's been as low as $13 a barrel as 1998. So given the price that we've got now, and, you know, why is the industry in the crisis it is now, when for 30 out of the 40 years it's been in operation, the oil price has been below $40 a barrel?
It was actually at $9 a barrel, around 2000. You need to get industry to answer that one. We can't get our heads around it either. We do know that they've been paying more for drilling rigs coming in, more for manufactured goods, more for engineers. But that's, again, a lack of investment. That's picking from the same pot rather than developing new people and developing people on the ground that they've got. So bad management, there's no question about it. And I think most of the top players will admit to that. They haven't managed it properly. Lack of investment and a lack of drive, which is why we've now got the Oil and Gas Authority to collaborate, has meant it's a high-cost environment.
In terms of Oil and Gas UK, I mean, recent job losses, one of the reasons they've given is some have also come from efficiency improvements as the industry looks to enhance its working practices. Basically, is oil companies using the lower oil prices an excuse to lay off workers in order to boost their margins?
To my mind right now, that's what it's become. It's become opportunistic. You know, they put workers on to 2 weeks on and 3 weeks off, telling them that it was good for work-life balance, that it was good for safety, it was good for their occupational health. They're now putting them back to three on, three off, telling them that they need to reduce costs on helicopters. No mention of the impact on their health of working 350 additional hours on top of the 1,800 hours that they already work. To me, that shows they're being opportunistic. And as I told the meeting yesterday, if we were really collaborating and really working to drive efficiency and maintain a safety culture which delivers, why not collaborate and make a standard in the UK sector as it is in Norway? Not 2 weeks on, 4 weeks off as it is in Norway. It's too late for that here now. But two on, two off for everybody. Not three on, four off, or three on, five off for Shell and BP and Marathon. Not two on, three off for Nexen. Not two on, two off for this one or that one, and three on, three off for the poorest of contractors. Give us a standard, and by doing so, you can collaborate to a greater extent and utilise helicopter seats, helicopter space, ships. Everything can be coordinated and collaborated around by adopting a standard.
And if you get a view on the future oil price, I mean, obviously, if we're going to get employment back and investment back, it's about getting that price back up again. And the World Bank in June estimated that oil prices will start climbing again and be over $60 by 2017. I mean, is that the confidence that you're getting elsewhere?
Get a crystal ball.
Yeah.
I mean, nobody really knows, do they? But I mean, I think in, you know, our written submission, we've referred to the economics of the industry fundamentally changing, and I think they have. And I think the introduction of US shale has, you know, been the kind of structural shock that the global industry hasn't had to cope with. They've had to cope with short-term, you know, and occasionally very significant fluctuations in the price. It's never had to cope with that kind of structural shock. I mean, I've been encouraging people to read this paper here. It's called The New Economics of Oil by a chap called Spencer Dale, who was until recently the chief economist at the Bank of England, now chief economist at BP. And basically his argument is the economics that have underpinned the industry for the last 30 years have changed in that which we used to believe about the industry. For instance, that oil is an exhaustible resource that will eventually run out, that oil flows from east to west, that OPEC stabilises the oil market, and none of these hold true anymore. And in that environment, I think the IEA's estimate that it will not return to above $80 until 2020 at least is probably about correct. The concern for that is, to go back to your previous question, is what is the break-even price in the North Sea? Well, people tell me it's $70 to $80, and certainly international evidence shows offshore production, you know, round about that category. So it's a major concern. Just very quickly, I know we want to move on, very quickly come back to a couple of your other points. I mean, I think it is massively important we recognise, you know, if the Norwegian sector is running 2 weeks on, 4 weeks off, and it's still holding that kind of productivity advantage over the UK continental shelf, I mean, that tells you something really quite dramatic about both sectors, you know. And I think rather than me speculating what might underlie that, I think my call earlier on for some, you know, pretty robust research to be undertaken and the differences between the sectors, I would go back to again. I think that would be very important, very valuable. Okay,
thank you. Chick Rosie.
Good morning. It's instructive after hearing Gordon's question. You know, the oil price rose by nearly 6% this morning, just because of national events, and that, of course, we can't predict these. I have two questions. One is, you talked about the impact of the local impact of downturn in the industry. What conversations have you had with, you know, further downstream in terms of the impact of oil production and lack of it on industries like life sciences? I mean, we all know that, you know, burning oil and you know, petrol and diesel, what have you, has environmental considerations, which will be addressed, I'm sure, over the next few years. But what conversations have you had with, as I say, downstream activities, manufacturers who use oil as a base product in their products?
It's something we discuss regularly with all the industrial sectors we work with. And I think, as you know, the work being carried out by ONS and others shows very clearly the falling oil price has been of significant benefit to a number of industrial sectors, those that use oil as a benefit. And as we try to say in our written submission, I mean, at global level, the falling oil price has been a very significant stimulus to the economy. It's probably the one factor that stopped the Eurozone falling into outright significant deflation last year. Across the UK as a whole, it's been estimated, you know, if the price holds around about $50, it will probably add about 1% to GDP over the next 4 or 5 years. So it has been a significant stimulus. But in Scotland, an oil-producing nation that is quite reliant on the North Sea, I mean, that situation does not hold. And certainly, we discuss this stuff in, you know, a very constructive way and in great detail with Scottish Government economic team. And, you know, 6 months ago, they thought the effect would be roughly neutral in Scotland. I think they are shifting more to a position that it will be negative, you know, and I think the data that we're currently seeing flowing through suggests that will be the case.
Okay, one other question. I'm sorry to personalise this, but it's about exploration. The last 3 years, I've been doing an exercise about oil and gas in the Clyde and the Atlantic margins. A village was built for oil workers, was built at Port of Addy, Ardrossan Harbour was occupied, was acquired rather. Key workers' houses were built in Alloway. More recently, half a billion barrels of oil being predicted just off Rathlin Island. There is now a probe going on to oil and gas in the Clyde and the Atlantic margins. And yet we focus, and I understand the depression around the North Sea. What push have you made as key players in this in terms of improving exploration outcomes as referred to in Ian Wood's report in terms of, you know, because we need to do that now. If the price of a barrel of oil is going to go up to $80 by 2020, then we need to be pushing as hard as we can, and I make no apology for being very parochial in terms of what might have happened over the last 30 years, but Mr. Heseltine, in his wisdom, stopped all drilling of a production licence, 262 for BP, because of nuclear submarines at Fas Lane. I mean, what effort can you make to encourage exploration in the areas that I've mentioned? We've already got the Clear Ridge field, of course, just off Shetland, which is supposed to be the biggest oil field ever. I mean, what efforts can we make to encourage more exploration and what would we say, and we might find out in an hour and a half, in terms of financing and encouraging more exploration activity? And as I say, I make no apologies for Clyde and the Atlantic margins.
Yeah, I mean, that's the new frontier. We've all recognised that for some considerable time. What efforts? Well, the efforts we are making is to ensure that we retain innovation, we retain investment in skills, we retain skilled and experienced people, and we drive oil and gas authority that's been created to drive that agenda, because that's where the skills which have been honed in the North Sea can be utilised on the new frontier. We don't want it being a frontier for social dumping and exploitation of foreign nationals. We want to exploit the resources of this country for the benefit of the people in this country. And that's on the agenda all the time. That's part and parcel of what we're doing.
Because the cost of production would be a lot lower because it's nearer shore.
The stuff that's nearer shore, yes, but the stuff that's further out, it's deep water, deep water. And you can't use the infrastructure similar to the North Sea, you're looking at shipping and transferring, and that's where, again, the Clyde diversification could be utilised quite significantly, would I thought.
Thank you.
Cultural shift would have to happen. My understanding in simple terms of Ian Wood's report was that the idea was there needs to be greater cooperation, less of the competition, more planning, and the benefit of that would be is, of course, as Jagan has just said, that we exploit the resources for the greater good of everybody, and we would welcome that, and we've been along to the meetings and we support that approach. So in a sense you would have national planning and regional planning bringing together at the same point you make not just the direct companies in the oil and gas, but other companies that are the customers, basically. I mean, we're producing a product that generates energy that goes right across our economy. It's not just buses, lorries that are using oil and the personal consumer, but it goes into factories for all sorts of production as well. And as a consequence of the money that's flowing in that, people are earning money. And that's my point, making that they then quicker spend money. They don't hoard it. They actually spent money, and then it gets back into the economy, and then we see things lifting up. We see the upturn coming, not just in this specific industry itself, but then we see the waves of investment coming right across the board. Now, that's what we want to aim towards, and I think that's what we want to see when we say we want everybody pulling together. Like Jake, I've been over to Norway, and I find that basically many years ago when I worked in construction with a foreman, he had a very simple statement. He said that the happy crew is the productive crew. And I worked in his crew, and I can tell you, he didn't crack a whip or break our backs, but we were always ahead of schedule compared to the other building squads where they did have the whipmasters. And that taught me as a young man the very simple lesson that how do you measure productivity? And I use this very carefully to say this. I think the experience in the Norwegian sector, there is this level of cooperation between the state, the trade unions and the employers there happen to be the same employers that are working on this side of the North Sea, yet the crews are, I use the word carefully, more content because they have all those infrastructures there, they've got the collective bargaining arrangements, they've got good terms and conditions, and there isn't a race to the bottom to make that workforce discontented, unhappy, that they then become unproductive. And I think there's an element of that that's going on here. And we need to get the national oil companies to realise this idea of keeping the contractors and everybody else on their toes, by having them fighting amongst each other and having them racing to the bottom as well, isn't a good business approach either. And again, that's where we believe that the state intervention comes in to say, right, the rules of engagement should be this is what we expect of you.
Thank you. Okay, thank you. Joan McAlpin.
Thanks very much. I'm going to return to this issue about the volatility of the price, and I just particularly wanted to ask Jake, who was around in 1997-98, and you saw that 40% drop in oil price between those 2 years. You must have seen quite an effect on Aberdeen and the economy. There must have been real concern then. So what's the difference between then and now? How did the city get through that? And
86, even the mid-90s, big falls. We had big oil fields. We had infrastructure that was fit for purpose. We had a great demand for oil, especially in the States. Today, as Stephen's alluded to, America's self-sufficient. That market's gone. The Chinese and Indian economies have dropped off. We've got very small oil fields with very old infrastructure. And that combination means that this time around, whilst it was bad in 86, I remember, all the hotels getting sold off and all the guest houses and Crown Street and everything going, and it was bad in the mid-90s. This time around, it's getting bad, but the fear is it's going to be bad for a lot longer and possibly, in some cases, forever. Because the fear now is that some of the big hubs, some of the older hub platforms, which lots of fields produce into, if they go down, then it wipes out huge areas. And the nervousness there's an atmosphere in Aberdeen in the industry which I've never encountered in 35 years. I've never seen anything like this in my entire history in the industry since 1980. And that's why I'm so concerned about what's going on across the board, every aspect of operation.
And from what you've, the evidence you've all given, that nervousness is allowing big oil, if you like, and other companies to exploit people.
Well, it's exploit people, but moreover, exploit our... I mean, I take great pride in the fact that we were the pioneers. We produced, the workers produced what we've got in the North Sea. Yes, big oil invested in us, but it was the workforce at the end of the day that delivered on it. And it's that exploitation of our natural resources, because it's still there, but trying to do it on the cheap and on the sly and the way that it's being done, the underhand approach, the lack of engagement, all of that is creating a culture and an environment which I haven't seen since 1986. You know, when we went back, I got, as I said, I got wakened up and told you're down the road along with another 7,000. When you went back, you kept your head down and you didn't engage, you didn't get involved, and the NRB, the not required back, loomed large. I don't think we're at that stage now offshore, but onshore, that's the environment we're creating. You know, when you sit and represent workers daily who are going through consultations and challenging their selection for redundancy, you get a feel for how deep this fear and concern is for their futures. As I say, it's appalling, the situation up there just now. I'm glad I'm going on leave at the end of the day for a couple of weeks.
And I noticed in earlier this year, Royal Dutch Shell, for example, were talking about drilling in the Arctic, going forward. Asked Patrick to cover his ears. I would have thought that is, I'm not an engineer, but technically very challenging and requires a huge investment. How can a company like Royal Dutch Shell talk about drilling in the Arctic and then give this impression generally that it's not commercially viable to exploit the North Sea?
You would really have to ask Shell, but I know they've pulled the plug on it now. $4 billion down the drain, lots of fines, and the reputation tarnished to a point that I doubt they'll get back up there again. They won't have it up there any longer, given their record up there. But the economics, I don't understand. I don't think any worker does.
And what about going forward in terms of, Stephen mentioned diversification into offshore renewables. Obviously, that slowed down in terms of investment, and the messages coming from the UK government have put investors off. Do you think there's any hope there? Do you have any optimism in terms of that particular sector, diversifying into that sector?
At this minute in time, no, because I don't see any investment, any interest in moving that agenda. You know, to me, it's a no-brainer. But there doesn't seem to be any real drive up here. I mean, I've seen it down south, around the south coast and up the east coast there. There's a lot of money being spent, and again, it's been done primarily by Dutch companies and Danish companies. We're losing out on that as well, and that's why I'm worried about the future. And if we don't grasp this is an opportunity that we need to exploit. Otherwise, we're going to lose it.
Yeah, thanks very much.
Okay, John Lemond.
Thanks very much. I'm very interested in. Effectively, you're saying that you are the hotline for people who are concerned. That makes perfect sense in an industry that's under pressure. Have you made representations to Health and Safety Executive directly about this so that they do recognise these are problems that have been identified to you of a seriousness and a scale? It's not just people not very happy about their work, but actually kind of things that Jake Molloy suggested about what may be happening in the future. And if you have done, what responses have you had?
Well, we have raised it, and we will always continue to raise it. we're totally against this idea of the move towards the 3-and-3 road. As again, the bounce back we get from the employers is that there's no evidence to show that it's less safer. In fact, the produced figures to us yesterday at the OCA meeting that showed that there are, in relation to the 3-3 rotas, less accidents happening. But as we pointed out, there's less people involved in the 3-3 rotas. But the issue we want them to address is to go and speak to the medics offshore, because we're anecdotally being told that medics are being approached by workers who are saying that, well, I've never approached a medic before, I've now gone because I'm feeling tired. Now, look at it in simple terms. If somebody came to you from the Scottish Ambulance Service or the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service and the management said, we're coming up with an idea to have 3-week rotas, we're going to have firefighters and paramedics and police officers as well working 21 days in a row and 12-hour shifts, what would your reaction be? And it's the same reaction offshore. Just because they think it was acceptable to work, you know, 14 days in a truck, that it's okay to do the extra 7. Because the serious concern is it's not just the 21 days. There's many times when offshore workers find themselves, they cannot get off the platform for reasons of the choppers aren't flying, and therefore they're staying on for the extra few days. And they're wanting to get home to their families. So, you know, there is a serious concern there. And we chip away and say to them, the sadness for us is that the hard evidence would only come when there's a significant incident. And that's what our greatest fear is, that it's fatigue. They were given figures yesterday saying, you know, how many people were maybe going to the medic for medication or, you know, first aid or something like that, injury. We're emphasising on it's on the mental well-being and the fatigue that people are experiencing, because that's the feedback that we're getting. Other samples is that there are people who are working 21 days on night shift, not just working during the day, but they're working nights. And they could be coming and finishing their night shift at 6 o'clock in the morning. The first chopper could be off at 7. They're coming on to firm land here, and they may well be living away from Aberdeen. And the temptation is, because they want to get home to their families, to continue driving. And we're saying to them that these issues need to be completely stopped and checked, so that you have the duty of care to take responsibility to say to the employee, you will be staying in the hotel because we know that you've just finished work and all the rest of it. But what they're doing is they're saying, well, if they want a hotel, you only have to ask. But we're saying, no, you need to be more proactive than that and saying, you know, you will stay. But so, you know, there is a very serious concern. So as Jake said earlier, the route is that we would prefer, of course, and listening to workers who had the benefit of the 2-1 and the 3 weeks off, then clearly our objective would be that when the upturn comes, a 2 and 3 is better for me, is definitely the roster that people would buy into. 3 weeks is definitely far, far too long, far, far too long. But again, the industry is exploiting the fact that people are worried about jobs. The point that's been raised earlier, as Jake says, every single day, as union officers, we're dealing with more and more redundancy notices. It's been like that now for months. I used to deal with the drilling side. Every day there was notices coming in. Now dealing with the offshore construction side, and it's redundancies, redundancies, redundancies. It hasn't stopped. We thought come the summertime maybe it would start to slow up, but it's continuing, and it's continuing, you know.
What you said about if this were, you know, a car factory, so on, the scale of the redundancies would cause alarm. I know anecdotally from one family in Lewis, you know, people that they know. An island community like that relies very often men go offshore to work, and it allows their families to grow up in islands. So I don't know to what extent have you, I suppose some people have the sense, well, these are itinerant workers, so they'll get work somewhere else. Are you able to track the extent to which when people become redundant, are they getting back into work?
Again, anecdotal story, fellow countryman yesterday, you know, when the call came through and I seen the email address, I recognised that it was Ireland, you know, Southern Ireland, from Donegal. And he said to me, he says, you know, lucky for me, Tom, I've got a brother in London. I've just been off the phone to him. And he's saying, well, if your job's finished, you know, at the end of the year, he says, just give us a call. There's work I can get you into. So workers in that industry will be, well, of course, now with social media and that, will be able to keep in touch with each other. So there will be some that will find themselves able to get into jobs on shore. But, you know, they've invested the time themselves. They've got into a routine. I think it's a very good point that you make, that the earnings that they're making is what's sustaining them in terms of their family unit. It's paying off their mortgage. It's giving them
a quality of life that they've become accustomed to, even though that they're away from home from time to time. So when that stops, basically, they, again, back to the point I was making earlier, the social responsibility comes in. So you can imagine, if you bring all this together under the one roof, it is the equivalent to about 12 shipyards closing. And if you had all those families living in the winter, the town would be finished, the city would be finished. But it's dotted all over the place, so we're only becoming aware of it because at a personal level, you know people. I mean, Jake's right. I've been in Aberdeen 30 years. I was there in 86. The project I worked in fact, was an unemployed workers' centre. And I witnessed that bust in 1986 and seen the serious impact of it. I always remember the guy came in one day and he said, I've just been to the bank and handed me, through the keys, he says, across the counter at them. He says, on my way home to my mum and dad, young person in the industry who had bought a massive house because they seen a future for themselves overnight. People, I remember, I think it was Brit Oil, workers turned up that Monday morning, met by security firms at the doors, marched to their desks. This was the onshore workers, keys of this and that, off the premises straight away. The humiliation of all that. As Jake says, now we have a situation where it just doesn't seem to be stopping at all. We can't say to workers, well, the turnaround's going to come next week. In the drilling side, I was getting told by drilling companies that they're looking into 2017, and the earliest kind of penciled in dates around about Easter. And they're just saying, earliest possible, not definite.
I'm very specific about whether unions involved in Oil and Gas UK's efficiency task force.
We were invited in January to participate, and we asked if they could ask their member companies to stop temporarily what they were doing by way of new rotas and cuts to terms and conditions. And we were told that they couldn't mandate for their member companies. And we were then forced to go back to our collective bargaining partners and try and negotiate with them. And we've endeavoured to do that throughout the year without any real success, which is why we're in the situation we're in now. But there is a chink of light. STUC and the unions have met recently with Oil and Gas UK through the Energy Jobs Task Force, and they have agreed through their ironically termed shared principles and values approach that they will meet with the trade unions to discuss our issues. So we're getting there. But to answer your question about health and safety, we meet with the HSE regularly, and we meet recently with Oil and Gas Authority and the CAA. So we do engage with all of the regulators about health and safety.
And just the very, very last question from me. I was very interested in what you had to say about UK seafarers, basically numbers and reducing from, or being excluded from the North Sea because of loopholes in the legislation. What would need to change in the legislation in order to protect the safety in that sector and protect these jobs?
Well, again, this is one of the frustrations that I've got. In fact, I've got a letter in my pocket here which I've been asked to give to every MP, but I'm not going to because it's not worded as it should be. But what it's talking about is the fact that no one from the UK can go and work offshore Australia, can go and work offshore Canada, can go and work offshore Brazil, could go work offshore Gulf of Mexico, America, even some regions of Africa, because of the cabotage rules there which dictate that employment must be drawn from the state, and only when there is a shortage of skills can you then look to engage workers from out with that jurisdiction. That doesn't happen here. You know, we've got ships with British workers that sail to these areas, and they have to be off those vessels and be replaced by those jurisdiction nationals. That's not happening here. And the only way I can see that could be averted, the demise of the British stroke EU seafarer, would be to have an EU caveat, an EU cabotage structure, which restricts employment on vessels servicing the exploitation of our natural resources to EU and UK seafarers paid at minimum wage. I'd even accept that as a starting point. Otherwise, as an island nation, And as an oil and gas producer, we're not going to have any British seafarers. That's a fact. That's what's... I mean, they've already taken a 25% cut to their wages. They're only earning £23,000 a year. They're now going to be able to work six on and six off in the North Sea to try and save their jobs, to try and compete. It's not a good place to be.
Can the UK government do something while the European Union works its way through establishing such a scheme? It feels like it would take a long time. Is there not something immediate that could be done at a UK level around employment legislation?
Well, extending national minimum wage to seafarers or extending the tier one, tier two immigration provisions for work permits might facilitate or at least restrict it in some way, but without that, it's the end for British seafarers.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks. Patrick Harvey.
Thank you. Good morning. Decommissioning has been mentioned, but only slightly, and I would like to explore that a little bit with you. I get the feeling sometimes that government is still, you know, a bit nervous about saying anything other than that decommissioning is a long-term opportunity. But there is decommissioning work out there already, and some of those bidding for it in Scotland are worried that they're going to lose out, that that work will go overseas because we're not ready, either because of skills or infrastructure, some of which is publicly owned and hasn't been invested in. Is there not a danger in the government being a little bit too cautious to embrace the opportunities that come from decommissioning because it worries about sending a signal that, you know, the North Sea is going to shut down before it's ready? Is there not a danger that we end up, as happened with manufacturing the high-quality jobs in the wind industry, for example, seeing somebody else get all of the benefit, and we carry on paying for that work one way or another, but we don't get that work in Scotland?
Absolutely.
I couldn't agree more. Yeah, I mean, my understanding is with the developments up in Aberdeen, with Aberdeen Harbour, when they're going to move up to Cove Bay, they could be in a position and should be in a position to do some decommissioning work. That if there's work going, we should be trying to use the term carefully, keep it in-house, keep it on our own doorstep, because it generates jobs, and that infrastructure should be there to do that. So again, that's back to the point I made earlier. It's about the planning of it, and it's about saying again to the oil and gas industry, where are you going with that? We can do that here. Mm-hmm. Why are you taking it somewhere else? So we start pointing the finger at them and making them more accountable. And then to cover the point was made, the question was made earlier, what could a government do? Well, this is your house, and you say these are the rules. You're going to operate within it. We're going to set the rules. We're going to say this is what's happening. And I think there needs to be a wee bit more of that, because they have it too easy for themselves. They seem to be the ones that's dictating everything. And it's about time that we turn that power relationship round. And I think if we do that, then at least we'll move some way towards that kind of planning to make sure that we're going to fight against the worst aspects of the industry as it will one day, probably beyond our lifetimes. The oil and gas might not necessarily be there. So these ideas that are in their infancy, we should be proud that we're still looking at that whilst we're dealing with the immediate situation, because then our children and their children's children maybe will look back in history and say, well, thank God way back in the early part of the 21st century, people did have the foresight to see 50, 100 years down the line that this is the way we're going to move towards. But we have an immediate responsibility to the people we represent, which is why we will proportionately concentrate most of our time on the oil and gas. But decommissioning is going to come, and as you say, that has happened and it is happening, so why shouldn't it be done on our own doorstep?
You mentioned planning, economic planning, and you mentioned that in your opening remarks as well, and I take the view as well that economic and industrial planning has to be part of how we manage change, how we manage a transition. Whether you take the view that that transition needs to happen now, or as Fergus Ewing takes the view that there'll be another 40 years of oil and gas extraction, that transition, that change has to happen. And if we don't want people who are currently dependent on an industry to be left on the scrap heap when that change comes, we need to plan for it. But I want to ask whether you're at least open to the possibility that that transition is happening now, that it is not in the long distance future. I'm going to quote from somebody here. Take, for example, the IPCC's estimate of a carbon budget that would likely limit global temperature risks to 2 degrees above pre-industrial levels. This is the target that the world is trying to move towards. That budget amounts to between 1/5 and 1/3 of the world's proven reserves of oil, coal and gas. If that estimate is even approximately correct, it would render the vast majority of reserves stranded. Oil, coal and gas that would be literally unburnable without carbon capture technology, which we don't have and in any case doesn't apply to transport fuels. Now, that wasn't an environmental activist speaking. That was the governor of the Bank of England, Mark Carney, speaking to a finance industry audience. And he went on to prefigure the possibility that any remotely credible climate change deal will result in a flight of investment from fossil fuels. Is it not seriously a danger that if we don't begin that transition now, if we don't invest in that transition now, we're going to be seeing, not in 40 years, but over the coming years, a continuation of the situation that's already begun in the Northeast? We need to begin that transition now and make sure that we're investing in the jobs that will last, not for a few years or a few decades, but for the long term.
Completely agree. Completely agree. We've got to do it now. And I think, as I said earlier, there are aspects of what's going on in other industries, the steel industry, the debate around Trident and others, which dictate that we should be doing it. And carbon capture is another area where we were leaders in that. And we've, whilst we've still got the possibility of it happening, to some extent, we should be investing in that and delivering on that. And I think that's another role for the Oil and Gas Authority to exploit as well. So, yeah, completely agree.
Do you, I wonder if Stephen Boyd might comment on this, or do you see any sign, because I don't, that the Scottish Government's economic strategy is placing its approach to the oil and gas industry in this context?
Well, I think in that respect, what's been interesting to me, although the Scottish Government have been very active through the Energy Jobs Task Force and driving a lot of helpful activity, I think in the North East, they have really not grasped, I don't think, the change in economics of the sector and what that means for Scotland. And I was extremely interested when, I think just a matter of weeks ago, the Council of Economic Advisers were before you and saying quite bluntly that they hadn't even considered the changes in the North Sea over the last few years, over the last year, and what that meant for Scotland, which I found really quite remarkable.
Which was particularly curious to me, given that Professor Muscatelli is the leader of an institution which is the first university in Europe to begin a fossil fuel divestment programme.
Yep. I mean, I think, Tommy, I agree with much of what you have to say. I mean, I think even if you took climate change right out of the equation and you focused on the change in economics of the oil industry that I discussed earlier on, I think that would shift you towards a position where you were looking at that transition happening much earlier than was previously anticipated. When I was reading a stat this morning that says, against BP research, but saying by 2035 the EU will be using the same amount of oil as it was using in the 1960s, even although the GDP will have quadrupled in that time. I mean, that is absolutely mind-boggling. And the UK and the US reached peak oil usage over a decade ago, and it's been on a continually downward trend ever since. So I think all these things taken together, the change in economics would suggest that we'd have to be planning for a shorter lifespan in the North Sea than what we'd previously considered. But I think there were the debate is so polarised in economic policy, as you know, that any talk of economic planning is immediately pigeonholed as central planning, you know, and so we're actually talking about, you know, government and private sector trying to manage a transition process more sensibly than otherwise be the case to maximise economic and environmental and social benefits for the country as a whole, you know, and I think if you take that as your starting point, then you would have a different approach to the industry than we have in the world.
Thank you very much.
And lastly, Richard Lyle.
Yes, thank you very much, convener. Most of the questions I was going to ask have been asked and answered. The point that Jake Molloy made, Britain has been a seafaring nation for hundreds of years. The British Navy, British Merchant Navy, but sadly has been on a downturn, and I certainly agree with the points that you made earlier. And with the greatest respect to Mr. Campbell, it's not our house, it's the UK government's house in regards to oil and gas. And my brief question is, Do you feel that the Oil and Gas Authority, which was established in April 2015 by the Department of Energy and Climate Change, has worked, and what involvement are they making? And I wish you well in all the negotiations and agree with all the points you've made.
Clarify, I didn't say it was a Scottish house. I said I used the term our house. In previous interviews I've given, I've pointed out that it was the UK continental shelf as well. The point that I was making was, when you own a house and you've got somebody coming in to do something in it, you can decide the rules. That was the point I was making, you know.
Something to add, but I mean, I think in OGE it's too early, I think, to be saying whether it's worked or not. I mean, I think that would be unfair given the scale of the task before it, the time it's had. But we had a very constructive meeting with them just a matter of weeks ago, very impressed by the Chief Executive, who I believe is before you next week. They've got a huge task. I think the early signs are promising, but the proof, as ever with these things, will be in the eating later on. And I think they've made a decent start. I mean, I think we certainly got the sense that they understand the nature of the challenges before them and the scale of those challenges, and certainly understand that it has to be a collaborative process, and certainly seem to value the trade union voice as part of that. But again, we'll just have to see how things pan out over the next few years.
Yeah, I think they've got a great title to their publication, A Call to Action. I love that title. It rings through with me. But as Stephen said, I think it's too early. But the big question which I posed to Sir Ian Wood when he took us up to brief us on his report and before the OGA was established was the regulatory leverage. Where is it? I still don't understand it, because if we've got poor performers, poor operators who refuse to collaborate, will not invest in their infrastructure, will not maintain their infrastructure. Sir Ian Wood said that they could see their licence revoked. So if we set standards and we expect those operators to meet those standards, if they don't meet them, what do we do with them? Sir Ian suggested that we just get another operator in. And I asked Sir Ian, what happens if we can't get another operator in? What's plan B? What are we going to do with the infrastructure? And nobody's yet answered that question. I suggested to Sir Ian that perhaps we could go back to the good old pre-Mrs. Thatcher days and have a UK oil PLC, Brit Oil type approach, which Sir Ian laughed at and suggested it would never happen. But the way things are going right now, I think we're going to reach that point at some stage, and the decision's going to be taken. What do we do with it?
Thank you, Cillian.
Thank you very much. We've gone a little bit over time, but I think that just demonstrates the breadth of the topic and the questions members want to ask. And I thank you all very much for coming along and giving of your time. It's been very useful to the committee. And we will now suspend and go into private session.